down. Probably wondering how come I got these glasses on. We're gonna do our big hit. Never did nothing, this one. A lot of people liked it anyway. One time when he was looking in the files about the time when the copper miners was having trouble with the copper mine owners, you know, and the owners was wiping out the miners and their kids. So he wrote this tune. true story, this tune. Take a trip with me in 1913 to Calumet, Michigan in the copper country. I'll take you to a place called Italian Hall, where the miners are having their big Christmas ball. I'll take you in a door in upper high school. Singing and dancing is heard everywhere. Before you know it, you're friends with us all, and you're dancing around and around in the hall. You ask about work and you ask about pay, and they'll tell you they make less than a dollar a day. Working there, copper claims and risking their lives, so it's fun to spend Christmas with the children and their wives. A little girl sits down by the Christmas tree lights to play the piano, so you've gotta keep quiet. To hear all this fun, you would not realize that the copper boss, thug men are milling outside. Copper boss thugs stick their heads in the door, and one of them screamed and he yelled, "There's a fire." A lady, she hollered, "There's no such a thing. Keep on with your party, there's no such a thing." Few people rushed, and it was only a few. It's just the thugs and the scabs fooling you. A man grabbed his daughter and carried her down, and the thugs held the door, and they could not get out. And others followed, about 100 more, but most everybody remained on the floor. Gun thugs, they laughed at their murderous joke, and the children were smothered on the stairs by the door. Such a terrible sight I never did see. We carried our children back up to their tree. The scabs outside still left at their spree. And the children that died there were 73. The piano played a slow funeral tune. The town was lit up by a cold Christmas moon. Parents, they cried, and the miners, they moaned. See what money has done. Light I never know. Ain't no use in turning on your light, babe. I'm on the dark side of the road, wishing there was something you would do or say to try and make me change my mind and stay. We never did too much talking anyway, but don't think twice, it's alright. Ain't no use in calling out my name, babe, like you never done before. Ain't no use in calling out my name, babe, 'cause I can't hear you anymore. Thinking and wondering, walking down the road, once loved a woman and child, I'm told. I give her my heart, but she wanted my soul. But don't think twice, it's alright. Thank you. going to do our other big hit. This was a big hit everywhere. In people's houses, all across the nation. Every once in a while they'd put it on, you know. Have a hit. This song is kind of a weird song. Guy played it in Philadelphia, got thrown off the air for playing it. It's not everybody's song, you know. Because I was thinking about it one time. I mean, I was thinking about, imagine, just turn that down. Imagine like an average guy, your average kind of weirdo freak, going over to Europe. Lots of chicks, lots of dope. Says, hey man, I ain't gonna bring one of these chicks back, but maybe I'll score me a little dope and haul it back, you know? Very dangerous number, you know? So he buys the Leaning Tower, you know, the little statue job. Stuffs it up in there, you know. Little Eiffel Tower, everything, you know. Stuff it in there. He says, man, I'm hauling this back, you know. I'm hauling this back, man. Wait on my friends. Wait on my friends, you know. He says that and he gets on the plane and he goes and he suddenly realizes he can't get off the plane. Neither can the dope. He starts thinking about the guy he's gonna meet at the other end. Cause there's two kind of guys in this world, you know. There's them that says that there shouldn't be any dope. And then there's them that says dope should be better. And I'm not siding. Wait a second. I ain't gonna side with anybody on that issue. Because I realize that the guy that says there shouldn't be any, he spent his whole childhood and his whole teenhood and most of his adult life dedicated to the proposition that there shouldn't be any dope. You know? And like most of you guys out there, you know, when the narc is sitting next to you, you know it. You know? But when you're getting off the plane, he knows it. And you're sitting there eating your airline fried chicken. You're thinking about that dope stuffed in the Eiffel Tower. Thinking about getting off the plane, and there he is, the other guy. And he's saying to himself, uh-oh, here comes some man, and he's got dope. And you're saying, oh no, what am I gonna do with this dope? You ain't gonna leave it on the plane. You can only eat so much dope. So figure out how long it's gonna take, and every so often you're taking another bite. I mean, you just bought back the best hash that there was in that continent, and you're gonna have to eat it. And there you are, eating a dope. But you can't eat it all. Just cannot eat it all. Even if you had Eddie, oh, that guy would know. I don't there's any way to solve this dope crisis, you know? I mean, because everybody, I mean, Mom's in the kitchen, right on the kitchen window. Mom's got her choice of these little jobs. And when the kids start screaming and the old man comes home, Mama's chopping on the pill, you know? She's chomping them down. Brother's up in the bathroom. Brother's been up in the bathroom for a while. Window's open, he's got the electric fan working, you know. Towel across the bottom of the door. Right? Nothing's getting out of that room. Sister's in the basement. Papa's in the garage. Pop's been in the garage for about 4 years, you know. He's been working on his job, his car that don't work, you know. But he's all excited about it, and his eyes are real bright and shiny, and he's talking all the time. My old minute can't stop him. Sister's still in the basement. The guy next door. It's not part of the dope crisis, you know, but just thought I'd throw it in there. There ain't no way to solve this, the dope crisis. Lest everybody gets it together. Lest they call like the family conference. And everybody agrees to bring in all their dope. Put it on the table. Out front. Real progressive families bring in sister and the guy next door. Put them on the table. Everything out front, you know. That's for all the liberal families. Everybody, just look at it right there on the table, you know. Son could say, Ma, your eyes just look down all the time, Ma. Try one of these joints, Ma. Father could say, Son, those eyes is red. Brighten up those eyes, boy. Here, take one of these uppers and brighten up them eyes. I don't know if that would solve the dope crisis, though. But now that I think about it, you know. I don't think it would solve it. I don't think it would solve it. The dope crisis, you know. Be a lot of free dope, though.
Yeah.
fine, do you, Jimmy Rogers? You like Jimmy Rogers, do you? We like him, that's how come we do it.
Settle me down in my dreams tonight. Tomorrow.
Settle me down in my dreams tonight. by sitting around a table that we got, you know. Might have been cruddy tables, you know, paint chipping off. And I was writing a song in the morning, and James Taylor's sitting on the other end of the table writing a song. Coming down. And the snow was coming down that morning with flakes that you would not believe, you know. Each flake was like that big, you know. And they were that far apart, so you could hardly see through the first thing of flakes, you know. You could only see like a couple of flakes looking out the window at a time. It's real weird. And I was writing this tune, and I got to a line in the tune that says, Jesus gonna make you well. No sun, the snow stops, sun comes out, comes through the window, lands on the piece of paper on the table. So James looks over, he says, what you doing? I said, I don't know, you know, it's kind of weird. I was just writing this line, all of a sudden, snow goes away, sun comes out, comes through the window, lands on the paper. It's heavy, you know. So anyway, I decided, and it went back to snowing while I was deciding on this. I decided I was going to use that line as part of the chorus, you know, in a song. And rather than just write cho or chorus or do this again with an arrow and an instruction manual, I usually just write out the whole chorus again, you know, so that when you're done with the song, it looks like there's a whole lot of stuff there, you know, and it's just a bunch of the same things all written down. So then I figured I'd try and sing it, you know, work out like a tune for the thing. Singing it and working out a tune, and every time I got to that place, man, snow stops, sun comes out, lands on the paper. Me and James kind of working out these harmonies to the tune. And we figured this was really great. We figured out that that line and that combination of notes preceding it would stop snow. We figured we'd go around stopping snow, you know. That was the spiritual heights that we attained that morning. It's really glorious, you know. Tried it in California once, too. Once, snowing or nothing, you know. Started to rain, you know. Thank you. We're gonna sing a cowboy song. If you guys was really hip, you know, you'd know it was a cowboy song just by that. Wouldn't be an authentic cowboy song, no. Because the cowboys, see, they never used to use these little flat picks. You know? They used to use them in the beginning, actually. The first cowboys that went around riding up, you know, picking and stuff. They used to use them. But the Indians used to come and rip them off, you know. Especially the medium gauge ones, you know. Really dug it. So like the later cowboy songs of the cowboy era, you know, are all done like, you know. You know, and then the Indians would come and chop the hands off them pickers, you know. So that didn't work out a whole lot. I don't know what they ever did to solve that, you know. It's kind of weird. Thought I'd tell you about it. Must have made the picks a lot cheaper so that the Indians could afford them in front, you know. Which would have been the smartest thing to do out in front anyway, you know. They don't cost a whole lot, these little things, you know. I mean, any Indian that wanted one could have one, if he wants, you know. Any regular sort of, you know, Puritan could have got one if he wanted it too. But they weren't into guitars, you know, the Puritans. They were into cowboy hats, though. Kind of weird. This is my father's cowboy tune. He didn't write a whole bunch of them. He wrote two. One got lost. I'm gonna sing you the other one. He wrote cowboy tunes because he was writing almost good stuff then, you see. And he wasn't making any money. He said, I'm gonna write just two songs, commercial songs, you know, make some money. These two songs made less money than the least of his other songs, you know. Till I recorded it. Now everybody sings this, you know, all the cowboys. They ride around playing this song, you know. Their jeeps, helicopters. Good tune. Sort of an animal recycling song.
Wind's blowing colder and the sun is
good night. Thank you, Eric. Anyway, this is what I was telling you about was Philadelphia, you know? And in the middle of Philadelphia, they got a place about the size of the inside of this joint, you know? And they got a few trees in it and stuff. Right in the middle of town, it's called Rittenhouse Square National Forest. It's right in there. And I was walking through the forest one day with three of my friends. And we right around the corner from this place is one of them monster ice cream joints, you know. And we went in there, and between the four of us, ate about 20 of the monsters that they had. So when we was going back through the park, it wasn't like we were running through, you know. We were doing that slow kind of puke walk that you do. You can't put another thing in your mouth, you know. So we was sort of barfing our way through the park there. I guess I had eaten more than anybody else, because I was way behind my three friends, you know. And so I could dig what was going on in the park, you know. Nothing going on in the park at all. It was real bad. Except for one guy who was running. You know, they got those 20-foot cement jobs so you don't step on the grass. Real weird, aren't they, you know. And some guy was coming in on one of them on the corner. Some chick was on his shoulder, and he was buzzing through the park, you know. And she was up there grooving and smiling and sort of bouncing up and down up there. And those two people met my three friends in the kiddie pool. There wasn't no water in there or nothing, so I guess so that the kiddies wouldn't drown or something, you know. And they met him in this kiddie pool. And without ever knowing each other or nothing, they all held hands, started to have the game ring round Rosie. I don't know if most of you clap because you remember Ring Around Rosie, because most people don't, man. You know? I mean, the only part they remember is a vague kind of holding hands job, you know? But the whole thing about Ring Around Rosie is, when you're a kid anyway, that you all fall down at the end. That's the most dynamite, incredible number, man. Standing up there with all your friends and just falling out right there, you know? So, before my friends had a chance to all fall down, they all got busted. They were busted for disorderly Ring Around a Rosie plan and other obscene crimes against the city of Philadelphia. You know? And I was really brought down about that. I was bummed out by the whole thing, you know. Because first of all, like, I wasn't arrested with them, you know. And I had always been arrested with my friends before. So I had that left out, alone in the world feeling, you know? So I went around the corner to the place I was working, and I got up on a stage and I wrote this tune. And the purpose of this tune, the only reason I did this tune on is to just wrote it right there, was to get everybody in the place after the show to go into the park around the corner and have a big mass Ring Around the Rosie in. Idea. Nobody came. It was just me. I guess I could have played with myself, but then I really would have got busted.